Just one dose of the Holy Ghost, not enough for me. Just one dose of the Holy Ghost, not enough for me. Just one dose of the Holy Ghost, not enough for me. Oh, just one dose is not enough for me.
Just excuse my pug in the background, the snorts and the noises. She's so beautiful, but she's quite noisy. So yeah, I've been wanting to get on here for a little while and do this video just to bless you, because Holy Spirit is always an edifier. He's always an encourager. He never tears you down. He always lifts you up. He reminds you of your identity in Him. He reminds you of who you really are. And sometimes when people get off track, Holy Ghost just gives them a little steering back on track into the right direction. Because He's always for you and He's not against you. Jesus. I know in my life He's definitely been the God of second chances. And not that I ever want to, you know, run my first husband down, but, you know, we both weren't spirit-filled or born again, and, you know, it wasn't the best, but God had told me not to marry him. And in Mandy's wisdom, she thought, it'll be right, mate. It'll be right, we love each other, you know. But God always knows best. He always knows best. And, you know, I probably went through 7-8 years of stuff that I didn't have to go through if I would have listened to him, and I would have been obedient to his leading. But I thought I knew better back then. And then sort of during the course of, after the divorce and getting born again, spirit-filled, you know, he healed all that stuff in me anyway. That sort of got me off tangent a little bit. That's not really what I was going to talk to you today about. But I was sort of preparing earlier, and Holy Ghost always drops little things into my spirit. And I was actually mopping the floors, and Holy Spirit said to me, Amanda, a lot of the blockages in people's lives come from their own mind. You know, do you believe that your own mind and your own thoughts can stop you from moving forward in life? I know in my life it has. And, you know, recently Holy Spirit has reignited some dreams that I've had in my heart for years, and it just had them buried. And Holy Spirit's reignited the dreams in my heart and made me want to chase after them again. And I said to God, I'm too old. I mean, I'm 45. I'm too old now. And you're never too old for God. You're never too old. Don't let your age hold you back. Your age is no barrier in God. So I hope that encourages someone today, because, you know, Holy Spirit certainly encouraged me with that. So I've got a few notes down here, but what I wanted to really talk to you about was the walls coming down. The walls are coming down, and let us shout for joy. Matt was talking to me about shouting the other day, and in the Bible, when you shout, you don't just shout. Like, it releases a frequency that can just burst stuff. And you know, like when they walked around the wall 7 times with Jericho, the wall crumbled down. So sound actually has a frequency. And we were talking about that a bit the other day. And I find it fascinating. I really do. But, you know, let us shout for joy. Let us shout in victory Let it change the very atmosphere as we shout. Sorry, I hope my dog's not annoying you too much. Let us shout for victory, because Jesus has already paid the price and already has purchased the victory on our behalf in every area of our life. But as we co-labor with God, and as we walk with God, he will bring about those promises. And that's what I was talking about earlier. That the lies in your mind or the thoughts in your brain that stop you from moving forward in God and stop you from taking on a new challenge or thinking you're too old or thinking you can't do it, you most definitely can do it. You can do anything through Christ who strengthens you. So the walls that we've built in our hearts, the walls that are in our churches, the walls between mothers and daughters, mothers and sons, fathers and daughters. I just believe that the Holy Spirit is tearing all those walls down. The walls of impossibility, again, that we've built in our minds. The walls of insecurity and inferiority. The walls of failure. You're not a failure. You're a victor. You are victorious because Christ has made you victorious. The word says that you are the head and not the tail. It, like Solomon, everything he set his hand to turned to gold. And that is what God does with you. He co-labors with you. He will bless whatever you decide to do. He puts those desires within your heart to, you know, want to do the things you do. As long as they're godly, of course, and they line up with the word. I'm not saying all things, but you know what I mean? The desires, the godly desires, the holy desires, he can put in your heart to ignite you, to move forward. We were talking the other day about the Australian church and how a lot of the ministers overseas don't even want to come here because we have some of the driest, hardest ground in the world. Just as well that God made me Australian. Just as well that I love Australia. Just as well that I believe, like God, that nothing is too hard for him. I believe great things for Australia. I really, really do. I know Australia has not come into her time yet. And I can't wait for it to happen. We have such a harvest here. And I just can't wait to see it. You know, in the Bible, God always starts off with nothing and he turns it into something. Like with Abraham and Sarah, they couldn't even have children. Yet God said to Abraham, I'm going to make you a father of many nations. You know, there's so many examples in the Bible where God turned what seemed impossible into the possible. Because with the power of the anointing and with the power of the Holy Spirit, nothing's too hard for God. And I'm believing that for Australia. You know, we're going to see great things come out of Australia. But I really believe in my heart of hearts, we need to let Holy Spirit rule and reign in every single church. You know, the sheep don't need another three-point sermon and they don't need a corporate prayer. And I'm not saying that God can't bless that, because he can and he does. You know, he will move in whatever way he can, and he's God, he's sovereign, he can do anything. But I really can't wait for the day where Holy Spirit's allowed to take the lead in our churches. You know, we should be seeing every church we walk into in full-blown revival. We should see people rolling around the floor, laughing, getting revived back to their first love. We should see the pastors and the people, laying their hands on the people and praying for them publicly, not out in some back room. But you know, some churches you go to, they don't even lay their hands on people and pray for them to be delivered or healed or anything. They just say this measly little corporate prayer and off we go till next Sunday. It's not good enough. I'm sorry. It's not good enough. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to rise up within our churches. And we need the church revived first before the world will come in. Jesus. And the Holy Spirit's speaking through me right now. I know he is, because he has given me this word for the church, that we need to rise up in power. We need to rise up in full authority that we've been given. And until we do so, our churches will stay bound. Our churches, the people in our churches will not get set free and they will not get delivered. The Great Commission is we shall go out and we shall lay our hands on the sick and they shall recover. How can we stand up on the platform and say a 2-minute corporate prayer and wish everyone out for the week? No one gets invited up to the front. No one gets hands laid on them. No one gets delivered. No one gets healed. Jesus, I mean, yeah, as I say, I'm not trying to be cynical and I'm not trying to be critical. Because Holy Spirit can move anywhere. And I'm not saying he doesn't. But I'm saying, church, we need to take it to a whole nother level. Do we want to stay bound as a country where no ministers want to even come here? Or do we want to accelerate every church in Australia? Do we want to accelerate it and get it to a point where they want to come? They can't wait to come. They can't wait to be invited. And I just prophesy that right. I just prophesy that right now, that all these ministers are going to be lining up. They're going to be wanting to come. They're going to be wanting to be invited. Not making excuses that they can't. Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you minister to whoever watches this video in whatever you're trying to get across, that the church needs to be like Acts chapter 2. And yeah, and I know pastors get up there and I know they say, you know, we need Acts chapter 2, but they don't do it. Acts chapter 2, 120 people in the upper room praying in tongues out loud, praying violently out loud for the Holy Spirit to come. Okay, most churches don't even speak in tongues because they don't want to offend people. We are watering down Christianity. We are watering down the gospel. We're not allowed to preach against this. We're not allowed to preach against that. We're not allowed to lay our hands on people. We are watering it down and we wonder why the church has got no power. Seriously. I might be coming across angry, but trust me, I'm not angry. I am fired up. I am fired up for this country. I am fired up for every single church in this country to get with it. If we don't get with it, we're not going to step into everything that God has for us. We're not going to step into the blessing. We're not going to step into, oh, geez, or it's going to be delayed. We can accelerate this. We can accelerate this. And I'm telling you, the time is short. The devil is out there running an absolute muck with this world. And what the world needs is Jesus. They mightn't even know that they need him, but trust me, when they get revived back to him, when they get set free, when they get delivered, when their mind gets renewed, when they know that the very God who created them lives inside them and loves them, they will think, oh, should have done this years ago. And I know the Holy Spirit draws people, and I know people have their times and all of that. But I tell you what, anyone that walks into a full-on revival meeting where the anointing is flowing, and I mean it's heavy, they can't help but get touched. They can't help but give their life to God. They can't help but run to the altar and get saved. They can't help but run to the altar and confess the sin that they're in to be delivered from it. Praise God. Jesus, praise God. Praise God, hallelujah. I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are doing a mighty work in this land. I thank you that those dry bones will rattle and they will form, and we will have an army march forth across this land, and no weapon formed against Australia shall prosper, and every tongue that rises in judgment shall be condemned. Jesus, I thank you for your Holy Spirit. I thank you, Lord, that this church walks as the early apostles walked, that we stayed and we prayed and we waited until the Holy Spirit was up upon us, that we were endued with power, and then we went out and disciples were added daily. They were adding 3,000 a day that were getting saved and brought into the kingdom. When you're flowing in the Holy Ghost, it is hard to resist. It really is. Unless someone's, you know, totally possessed, it's really hard to resist. You just know that that person's got something. You know that person's different. You just want to talk to them. You know that you just want what they've got, even if you don't know what it is, even though, you know, we know it's the Holy Spirit. But someone that doesn't know the Holy Spirit yet, their spirit still knows. They still know that they want it and they need it, and that, you know, he is the love that they've been missing out on their whole life. I said to my son the other day, he's 17, and I said, do you think you need God? And he said, oh, yeah, but not really. And I said, darling, you need God. Everybody needs God, right from the highest of the high to the lowest of the low. And don't get me wrong, God's no respecter of persons, and I'm the least judgmental person out there. But if you're homeless, you need God. And if you are the highest of the high, whatever that may be in your opinion, you know, whatever, the Prime Minister of Australia, a judge, whatever your highest of the high is, you need God as well. Everybody needs God, no matter who you are. We were born to be in relationship with God. We were born to walk as children of God. And we were born with eternity in our hearts. You know, if we really care for the sheep like we say we do, if we really cared, we would not want to see them bound. We would want to see them free. We would want to see them revive back to their first love. We would want to see them going out and bringing more people in, not just keeping them in our church because we may lose them. And or the offering message, the offering might go down. Who cares? It's not about that. It's not about your little church. I'm sorry. There's a whole bigger picture at play here. And we need everyone revived back to their first love. If you're not ecstatic, if you haven't been totally revived and filled with joy, like Psalm 23 says, my cup overfloweth. He anoints my head with oil in the presence of my enemies, and my cup overfloweth. That means there's so much that I can't even contain what he's pouring out through me, and it overflows. And that the overflow is what feeds others. And the same with you. You are full to overflowing in the Holy Spirit. What is flowing out of you? Out of our belly shall flow rivers of living water. We're Christians and we're spirit-filled, and we cannot separate ourselves from the world. No matter where you go, no matter what you do, the Spirit goes with you. The kingdom of heaven is within you. So no matter what you're doing, he's right there. That's so beautiful. So, please don't water it down. Please don't water it down. That's all I'm saying. Let's get serious with this thing. Time is short. The enemy is out there seeking whom he may devour. Our children. Jesus. Jesus. The enemy is out there prowling around, destroying marriages, destroying our children through drugs and alcohol and sex and all the nasty stuff that is meant to be in the sanctity of marriage. I'm talking about sex, that is, you know. When a husband and a wife have sex, it is sanctified. It is considered holy. When you run around and sleep with God knows who every day of the week, that is not holy. It's profane, and you are just hurting yourself. You are hurting your body. You know, the scripture, your body is a temple. Your body is a temple. If anything, I pray that you would get an understanding of just who you are through this video, that you would understand that I am worth something, that I do not deserve my current level of where I'm at right now. Like, God's going to take me higher. He's going to take me up here. And that's what I deserve. I don't deserve anything less. I will not tolerate mistreatment. I will not tolerate poverty. I will not tolerate sickness. I will not tolerate disease. I will not tolerate unemployment. I will not tolerate anything. I try and keep these videos quite lighthearted and happy. But as I said, I'm sick of playing church. I'm so sick of playing church. And I don't play church. But I'm so sick of, you know, just everything being airy-fairy, and yeah, that's great, and it makes you feel good for 2 minutes, and then you go back to whatever you were doing. Well, I've had enough of that. You know what? I'm so serious about this. I won't give up on anybody, and I really won't. But at the same time, you've got to get on board with this. If God wants to get real with you, He wants you to get real with Him. He can do amazing things in your life. I mean, mind-blowing things. He's turned me into a brand new person. I don't even think the same way I used to years ago. Yes, telling someone the other day, years ago I used to always walk around with a sense of dread that something bad was going to happen. I don't even feel like that anymore. I feel like something good's going to happen. Because that's what God does. He makes the good happen in your life. Whatever you put your hand to turns to gold. He can give you the anointing for wealth. He can prosper you. He can open doors that only He can open. And He can shut doors that only He can shut. He can heal you. He can deliver you. He can set you free. He can set you up for the best future. If you allow Him to. He can allow you to prosper so much faster than you can do in your own self-effort. I'm going to pray for you before I finish up. I hope you got something out of it. Please comment below. I love reading the comments and I love praying for you. I want to see God's best for you. Every single one of you. I don't want to see you struggling with depression. I don't want to see you struggling at all. We love you. God loves you with an everlasting love. His love is perfect. His love is true. You can trust him. This much I know is true. Jesus. Just giving you a minute to let it all sink in. You may be relaxed, you may be at peace in him. Holy Spirit, I thank you for your peace. I thank you that whoever watches this video feels your presence as you speak through me. They would know that you know the most intimate details of their life and that you have a plan and a purpose for their life. So I pray that you would know the truth and the truth would set you free. Only the truth that Jesus can offer. Only the truth that relates to your reality. Only the truth that you are a child of God and that he has a plan and a purpose for you. I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are a God of second chances. Just like in my life, that no one's too far gone for you, that they can start right now by rededicating their life to you, by saying, Jesus, I want what you've got. I want to know that you have given me all power and all authority, that I'm a child of God, that I'm filled with your spirit. I want to know in my heart of hearts that that's me. That I've been included in this gospel. If you feel this speaking to you right now, just say this prayer with me. Jesus, come into my heart. I make you my Lord and Savior. Amen and amen. And if you want to rededicate your life to God, if you've been like a prodigal and you've gone away and gone back to the world for a while and you want to come back, you know that the door's always open. You know that you can come back anytime you want, that he's waiting for you. And I pray his protection over you and I pray his love over you. I pray that not one would be lost. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Please continue to pray for Matt. Matt's up and down in his sickness. You know, he has good days and bad days. And obviously some days are better than others. But we're believing for a full miracle in his body. It's only something that God can do. Doctors cannot heal him. Medication cannot heal him. He needs a miracle, and it would be undisputed miracle. The doctors would be confounded. They would have to know it was God, because what he has is incurable. So please keep him in your prayers. We're believing for a full turnaround in Jesus' name. Amen.
The School of the Anointing is brought to you by the partners and friends of Matthew Ford Ministries. For more information, or to register free, go to www.matford.org/mtc.